what we have done in the last class.
Sir, we did torque equations.
Torque equation we have done. You are able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. And what else? In the torque equation, what we have done?
So how long will the link for tomorrow's exam be open, sir?
Somebody said something. Can you speak a bit loud? Ronak, please tell everyone what we have done last class. Properly tell what all things you have done in 4 hours in the last class. Ronak, are you able to speak?
First, you can ask.
Exactly.
Skanda, can you explain everyone what we have done? Skanda left. Okay, Tripan.
Sir, you taught us about torque and then you taught us about T is equal to I alpha and we solved questions based on that equation.
Okay.
That's all.
All right. So today we are going to discuss about the work energy on the rigid body. All right. Please write down.
Can you solve some questions on the assignment website?
Yes, I am going to do that. But right now, let us start with this concept, okay? We have done a couple of questions on torque equation, right? Last class as well. So let us complete the theory part of this chapter. Then we'll take up a lot of other questions as well, okay? Write down work energy on a rigid body.
You can keep it up on this also. No, what difference is it make? But your elbow has to be over there.
Yeah, you're audible.
Or do you need it again?
No, it's okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
Check if your elbow is in, especially when you're writing at the bottom of the book. When you're writing at the bottom of the book, you'll have to move it up like this and then keep it.
Yeah, you're audible. You please don't talk in the background, okay? If you want to talk, please put yourself on mute. Fine. So we are going to discuss how can we use work energy concept on a rigid body. All right. We have learned in the work per energy chapter this concept that work done is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Isn't it? Now, this concept, although we have learned, but we have been using this concept for point masses or for the masses that are only doing translation. Okay. So in this topic, we are going to learn how to use this work energy theorem or this particular equation itself on a rigid body. All right. For example, fan. Can you tell me, is fan having any kinetic energy? Does fan have kinetic energy? Does fan have kinetic energy? Quickly tell. I have to take it. Does the fan has kinetic energy? Ronak? Yes, Ronald said yes. I can't speak. All right. So, see, the thing is that even though the fan is not moving anywhere, all right, fan is fixed. All right, it has a fixed axis of rotation. Then also, it has kinetic energy. Okay, because all the particles on the fan, let's say this is fan that is rotating like this, all right, all the particles on the fan, they are moving with certain velocities, right? So if you add up all the individual kinetic energies, you'll get the total kinetic energy of the fan. The center of the fan is at rest, but the particles which are away from the center, they have some finite velocity and hence some finite kinetic energy. So total kinetic energy will be the summation of all the kinetic energies of the individual particles. Fine. So the problem with this rigid body is that you cannot write kinetic energy as half mv square simply. The reason being that the entire fan is not moving with the same velocity. Which velocity will you take? Okay, center of mass is also at rest. You can't say half mvcm square, then the kinetic energy will become zero. But we have just learned that it has some finite kinetic energy. Every particle has some kinetic energy, and kinetic energy cannot be negative. So when you add up all the kinetic energy, it will come out to be a positive quantity. All right, so we are going to learn how to write kinetic energy for a rigid body. Fine. So let us try to do that. So for rigid body, there are three cases. Case number one, only translation. What is only translation? Only translation means what? The entire rigid body, suppose this is the rigid body, it is moving as it is, without rotating, okay, with velocity, let's say V. All right, so the orientation of a rigid body doesn't change. All the points have the same velocity. So when you write down kinetic energy is summation of all the point masses kinetic energy, like for example, M1 V1 square, M2 V2 square, and so on, since all the points have same velocity, the velocity square by 2 comes out of summation. So it will be like this, okay? And summation of mi is total mass. So it will be simply half mv square, right? So if body doesn't rotate, you can treat as if it is like a point mass, and the kinetic energy will be equal to half m into v square, where v is the velocity of the entire body, which is same throughout. Fine. All of you understood this? Case number one?
Yes, sir.
All right. Case number two. Write down case number two is rotation about the fixed axis. All right, so the rigid body is not going anywhere, but it is just rotating about a fixed axis. Suppose this is the rigid body, all right, and this is rotating about, let us say, that axis. This is the axis about which the entire rigid body rotates, and the angular velocity of rotation is given as omega. Fine. Sorry. Angular velocity is omega. Fine. So we are trying to find out the kinetic energy due to rotation of the entire rigid body. So I'll assume that entire rigid body is made up of small point masses. Let's say this is a point mass M1 at a perpendicular distance R1 away from the axis. This is point mass M2 at a perpendicular distance R2, and let's say this is at a distance R3, a point mass M3. So similarly, there can be n different point masses on the entire rigid body. So rigid body is made up of all the point masses. Fine. Can anyone tell the velocity of point mass one? How much is the velocity of point mass one? Aditya Narayan, tell everyone what is the velocity of point number one if angular velocity is omega and perpendicular distance is r1. Aditya Narayan, you have to unmute yourself. Let me unmute you.
Sir, is it r1 omega?
Correct. It is r1 omega. So all the point masses are moving in a circular path with center on the axis. Fine. So if it is circular path, the velocity of point mass m1 will be equal to r1 into omega. Fine. So kinetic energy of mass m1 is what? Simply half m1 into v1 square, right? Where v1 is r1 omega. So this will become half m1 r1 square omega, right? Similarly, you can write down kinetic energy of the second particle as half m2 r2 square omega. So like that, you can write for all the point masses. And when you add up all the kinetic energies, you'll get the total kinetic energy of a rigid body, which is equal to summation of half.
Sir, shouldn't it be m1 r1 square omega square?
Yes. It will be whole square, so that's why. So mi ri square omega square, right? Now, which of the quantities in this expression are constant at a particular time?
Mass and radius.
Mass of point masses can be different, okay? Half is constant and omega is also constant. For entire rigid body at a particular moment, omega is constant, so half omega square comes out, and this will be summation of mi ri square. What do you think summation of mi ri square is?
Moment of inertia.
Moment of inertia about which axis?
About any axis.
Now look at here. You have, see, ri is a perpendicular distance from this fixed axis. So this is the moment of inertia about the fixed axis. Fine. Kinetic energy is equal to half moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega square. This is the kinetic energy. So we have just derived the way to write the kinetic energy for a rigid body which is rotating about the fixed axis. Are you getting it? Any doubts? Aditi, any doubts? No, sir. Okay, fine. All right, so let's take a small numerical on this. All of you, try attempting this. Suppose there is a rod of mass M and length L, okay? It is rotating about this axis, which at a distance of L by 4 from one of its ends. Okay. About this axis, which comes out of your screen, it is a fixed axis. The entire rod is rotating and the angular velocity is given as omega. You need to tell me what is the kinetic energy of this rigid body. Hello. Anyone got the answer? Pratham, you got the answer? Okay, Mayur is telling the answer. You can type in if you are like, you don't want to speak, you can type it out.
Sir, is the mass uniformly distributed over the rod?
Yes. If nothing is said, you assume that mass is uniformly distributed, always. Okay, please tell your answers. Tripan, did you get?
Sir, is it 7 mL per omega square per 96?
Okay, Shomik, did you do this one?
Just 2 minutes. Sir.
See, this formula you have to use. I about fixed axis into omega square by 2. So basically, you need to find moment of inertia about that axis. Fine. How can I find moment of inertia about that axis? I can use what? Parallel axis theorem. About the center of mass axis, I know the moment of inertia is ml square by 12, right? And from center of mass, this distance is equal to L by 4. So this plus m into L by 4 whole square. This is the moment of inertia about the fixed axis. All right. So substitute that instead of this IF, and that is the answer. Okay. So like this, you can find the kinetic energy of any object. We'll take one more numerical here. Suppose this is a disc, all right? It's a disc, mass m and radius r, fine? This disc can be rotated about that axis, all right? The axis lies on the plane of the disc, fine? And this distance is r by 2. All right. Let's say the angular velocity is omega. Tell me what is the kinetic energy of for this disk. Anyone got this? Okay, Vibhav is telling one answer. Okay, Shristi also told Mayur, Shomik. It's okay to be wrong. If you're getting wrong answer, don't think before answering. All right, so again, I have to use the same formula, half moment of inertia about fixed axis into omega square, right? Now, this is the fixed axis, the white horizontal line. So I have to use the parallel axis theorem to shift this axis from center of mass to here by a distance of r by 2. So this is my ICM, which is parallel to the fixed axis. But what I know is moment of inertia about the axis that comes out of the plane, okay? So that moment of inertia is mr square by 2. So now I'll use perpendicular axis theorem and I'll say that moment of inertia, which is mr square by 2, is the sum of ix and iy, ix plus iy. And since ix and iy are symmetrically placed, this will be equal to 2 times ix. So ix is equal to mr square by 4. This is my ICM. So moment of inertia about fixed axis will become ICM, which is mr square by 4 plus, now I have to shift it parallel to itself, mr by 2 whole square. So this will be equal to mr square by 2. Fine. This is my moment of inertia about the fixed axis. So kinetic energy is half moment of inertia about fixed axis into omega square. So you are getting m r square omega square by 4. Okay, Ariman got it correct. Aniruddha as well. Okay, I'm assuming all of you understood if you have made any error here. Even Shomik got it correct. All right, Shristi, Mayur, have you understood where you went wrong? Anurag?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, so let us talk about how to write the kinetic energy of a rigid body which doesn't have a fixed axis. For example, let's say I have a rigid body like this. All right, this is moving forward. This is, let's say, VCM is given to me and also it is rotating. Okay, while it is moving forward, it is rotating with angular velocity omega. All right, I have to find out the kinetic energy for this case number 3. All right, so we'll try to prove that, how much it will be. Let's divide this entire rigid body into multiple point masses. Let's say this mass is from center of mass, its distance is, let's say, r1. You can say r1 vector is the position of this mass m1. Okay, so I know that when I have to observe a point in a rigid body, first I observe with respect to center of mass, then I'll add the center of mass's velocity to find the total velocity. So V1 velocity will be equal to velocity of center of mass plus R1 cross omega. All right. This is the velocity of point mass m1. So kinetic energy of point mass m1 is half m1 into vcm plus r1 cross omega square. Okay, square means putting a dot product with itself. So this will be equal to half m1 vcm square plus r1 sine theta whole square into omega square. See, this is a cross product, right? So it will be r1 into omega into sine of angle between r1 and omega, fine, plus 2 times vcm dot with r1 cross omega. Now r1 cross omega, here again I'll simplify it as r1 sine theta into omega. Can anyone tell me what is the angle between r1 and omega? Omega is coming out, it is along the axis, fine. R1 is on this plane, so the angle is 90 degrees, fine. So since angle is 90 degrees, I can write it as half m1 vcm square plus r1 square omega square plus 2 vcm, okay, dot with, let's say it is r1 omega. This is the kinetic energy of point mass m1. Total kinetic energy is summation of that. So summation of all the kinetic energies will be equal to half summation of mi vcm square plus half summation of mi ri square into omega square plus 2 vcm omega dot with summation of mi ri. All of you understood this till now? Now tell me, vcm is constant, right? So it comes out of summation. So the first term will become half vcm into summation of all the masses, which will be total mass, half m into vcm square plus, what is this term inside the bracket? This is what?
Moment of inertia
about which axis?
The center of mass axis, the moment.
About the center of mass, because r1 is a perpendicular distance from the center of mass. So this will be half ICM into omega square. Now, summation of MIRI divided by summation of MI. This is what? Position vector of the center of mass, isn't it? Now, position vector from which point? I am measuring position vector of the center of mass. When I do that, RI is what? RI is a distance from the center of mass. So this will tell me the location of center of mass from the center of mass itself, which is zero. The summation of MIRI is equal to zero. All right. And hence kinetic energy is this. The third term becomes zero because this is equal to zero. This derivation is not in your syllabus, but I thought I should tell you everything. So here it is. All of you understood how to write kinetic energy? Half mvcm square plus half moment of inertia about center of mass into omega square. Is it clear? Okay. Now I'm going to tell you an easy way to remember the kinetic energy. So first of all, there are two cases, fixed axis and axis which is moving. All right. You might be wondering that can I use the second case to find the kinetic energy and will I get the same answer? Okay, let's check that. Take for example a rod which is rotating about one of its ends. Let's take mass M and length L. This is the fixed axis. One of its end is a fixed axis. It is rotating with angular velocity omega. You need to find out its kinetic energy, which is moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega square. And this should also be equal to half MVCM square plus half ICM into omega square. Just check both of the equations are getting you the same answer or not. Apply both the equations over here and tell me whether you're getting the same thing. Getting the same thing?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. See, this will give you half about one of its end moment of inertia is ML square by 3. This into omega square. Fine. Whereas if you apply that formula, you'll get half M into VCM square plus half ICM is ML square by 12 into omega square, right? And you can write down this VCM is at a distance of L by 2, right? This distance is L by 2. So VCM is omega into L by 2 as well. Fine. And when you substitute it over there, you'll get half M into omega square L square by 4 plus half ML square by 12 into omega square. So you can see that if you take, let's say, half ML square by 4 into omega square common, you'll get 1 plus 1 by 3, and you're going to get the same answer, half ML square by 3 into omega square. Right? So it does not matter which formula you use, you'll get the same answer for the kinetic energy. Okay. Unlike the torque. Torque about one axis will be different from torque about another axis. But when you find the kinetic energy of a rigid body, it doesn't make sense to say that kinetic energy about one axis or the other. you should get the same answer irrespective of whatever axis you take. But the formula which you have is either about the fixed axis or about the center of mass axis, right? So if you have a fixed axis for a rigid body, it is advisable to use the fixed axis formula, which is half IF into omega square. But if you're not able to locate the fixed axis, it is safer to use this formula. Okay, so this formula will be like, you know, you can remember it like that. This could be treated like kinetic energy with respect to center of mass. Okay, loosely you can say that this bracket term is kinetic energy with respect to center of mass, because with respect to center of mass, entire rigid body, you can feel as if it is rotating with angular velocity omega. So half IC omega square is kinetic energy with respect to center of mass plus kinetic energy of the center of mass, which is half MVCM square. So like that, you know, it will help you to remember.
Sir?
Tell me.
Sir, if there's some body that's rotating about some axis other than the center of mass.
Speak a bit loud.
So if there's some body rotating about an axis which is not the center of mass axis, but some other fixed axis. It's an axis and then it's moving. Sir, for that, the kinetic energy, in that also we have to use the second formula and substitute ICM, sir.
Yes. Okay. This formula is generic formula, the second one. Whereas the first formula can be utilized only when there is a fixed axis. Okay?
Okay.
All right, so let us try to see scenarios where we can use the second formula. For example, let's say it is a sphere of mass M and radius R, okay? This sphere is rolling without slipping with angular velocity omega, and it is rolling without slipping on a horizontal surface, let us say. Okay, on this surface, it is rolling without slipping. You need to tell me what is its kinetic energy. How much is the kinetic energy of this? Are you seeing any fixed axis here? Abhishek, are you seeing any fixed axis? Abhishek, you're on mute. Let me unmute you. Abhishek. Yeah, Abhishek, tell us. Abhishek, speak. Are you seeing six axes, Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
Where? Arpita, what do you think? Are you seeing any fixed axis?
No, sir.
All right. It is okay. If you're not seeing any fixed axis, you can anyway use the formula half MVCM square plus half ICM omega square. Use this formula to get the answer. Simply have to substitute the values. Try doing it. Shaumik, you're getting a wrong dimensions. How can you add 2 by 5 with omega square?
Sir, is it 7 by 10 MR square omega square?
Okay, others? What is the relation between omega and VCM for condition for no slipping on a fixed surface? VCM is equal to omega R for condition for no slipping on a fixed surface, right? So half M into VCM, which is omega square R square, plus half into ICM is 2 by 5 MR square. It is a solid sphere. Okay. So you're getting 7 by 5 MR square omega square as your kinetic energy. Anybody got 7 by 5?
Sir, it's 7 by
7, 10. 7 by 10, sir.
7 by 10, I'm sorry, 7 by 10. Okay, so I can see that Krishna got it. And anybody else?
Yes, sir, I got it.
Okay, Vibhav considered it as a hollow sphere. That's fine. Have you understood, all of you? Any doubts? All right. Okay. Fine. Let us move to the next topic. Just give me 1 second. Yes, so now that we know how to write the kinetic energy, we need to also learn how to write the potential energy of a rigid body. Because if it is a point mass, then we just write mgh as potential energy, right? But if it is a rigid body, okay, rigid body can be located from one height to the other height, as in it is not a point mass, right? So you can say that this is my rigid body. Okay, and let's say this is your ground. So starting from height h1, you have the rigid body all the way up to height h2. All right, so we should also learn how to write the potential energy. So next is how to write the potential energy of a rigid body. Okay. So again, we will consider the rigid body is made up of point masses. So let's say this is mass M1, which is at a height of H1. This is mass, let's say M2, which is at a height of H2. Okay. So potential energy of mass M1, you can say small U1, U1, potential energy of mass M1, is M1 GH1. U2 is M2 GH2. All right. So total potential energy will be sum of all these potential energies. So U will be equal to sum of MI GHI. All right. Assuming G is constant throughout the rigid body, it will be equal to summation of MI HI, okay, and summation of MI HI divided by summation of MI. This I can say this is height of center of mass, yes or no? This is the formula, right? I can say that this axis is my y axis along the height. So the H is my Y coordinates. Anurag can't see anything. Others, are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Summation of MIHI. Anurag, you can rejoin. This will be equal to summation of MI into H center of mass. Summation of MI is total mass, this into HCM. So potential energy can be written as MIHI is M into HI. So M, so MIHI is M into HCM. So M HCM into G. So if I write it like this, MG into height of center of mass. So this comes out very nicely. If I have to write the potential energy of a rigid body, all I have to see at what height the center of mass is. Okay, I don't need to track anything else. I just need to see where is the center of mass, what is its height, and MG into height of center of mass is the potential energy. Okay, so you can treat as if entire rigid body is a point mass located at the center of the mass. Okay, so now we know how to write the kinetic energy of a rigid body and how to write the potential energy of a rigid body. Now we can use work energy theorem for the rigid body as well. Okay, is there any doubt? If there are, please tell me. Otherwise, I'll move forward. Okay, no doubts. Are you guys prepared for tomorrow's exam, KMON test? Some of you are not attending the class also because of that. Okay, all of you 100% prepared, it looks like. Suppose this is the rod, it can rotate freely about one of its end. Okay, it can rotate in a vertical circle with, okay, like that, about this fixed axis passing through its end. Total mass is M, total length is L. Okay, you need to find out what will be its kinetic energy. Not kinetic energy, you can say what will be its angular velocity when the rod becomes vertical like that. It will start rotating and then the rod will become vertical. So when it becomes vertical, what will be its angular velocity? Find out. Omega is what? You have to apply work energy theorem between this position and that position. Position when the rod is horizontal, that is first one, and second one is when the rod is vertical. Skanda, I'll talk to you after the class. you can put these kind of messages personally. You don't need to let everyone know. Okay, Shaumik is giving answer. Others? Tirpan, Arman. Ravi Kiran has also given an answer. All of you should attempt. Arpita, what is your answer? One minute. Okay. Shristi, Vibhav. See, I remember everybody's name now.
Sir, under root 3G by L.
Okay, most of you are getting that answer only. Should I solve? All right, so I have to use work done. Whenever I'm using work energy theorem, I have to use between the two time intervals. Okay. First, the first instant is when it is horizontal. Second instant is when it is vertical. Okay. So I'll take this horizontal line as my zero potential energy. So whenever I'm applying work energy theorem for gravitational potential energy, I have to consider an imaginary horizontal line as my zero potential energy, right? So I'm saying that this is my zero potential energy. Ug is equal to zero for that, right? So in the first instant, I have to write the potential energy, and potential energy of the rigid body is what? Mg into the height of center of mass from the zero potential energy, which at first instant is zero. So U1 is zero. Kinetic energy is how much? Even K1 is zero. The entire rod is at rest. Okay. U2, you can see the center of mass has moved down. By what distance? It has moved down by a distance of L by 2. So what is the potential energy now?
Minus mg L by 2.
Minus mg L by 2, like the way we have been doing till now. Okay, there is no change. Minus of mg L by 2. Kinetic energy, I can clearly see there is a fixed axis. So I'll directly use the formula that half moment of inertia about fixed axis into omega square. All right. And about the fixed axis, moment of inertia is basically ml square by 3. Okay. And how much is W? Are there any forces on the rod that are doing work? Gravity was one of the force, but for gravity, you have considered the potential energy. So you don't calculate the work done by the gravity. Any other force on the rod? Anirudh, any other force on the rod? Okay. And why MgL by 2 negative? See, it is negative because it is, the height is below the zero potential energy line. If the height is above, if center of mass would have been there, it would have been positive potential energy. If you are below, it is negative potential energy. That's how we have been using in work for energy chapter also. Okay. Now there are forces other than gravity. The hinge, the axis where it is tied, there will be forces. All right. But the good thing is that the point on which the force is applied, that point is not moving anywhere. Okay. So displacement of the application of force is zero. So even though force is there, displacement is zero, and hence work done is zero. So when you solve it, you will get omega as root of 3g by L. Clear? All right. Now let's modify this question a bit. Assume that rod has rotated by an angle. It has rotated by an angle of theta, let us say. All right. Now you have to find the angular velocity. Earlier it has rotated by an angle of 90 degree. Now it has rotated only by an angle of theta. Find out the angular velocity in this case. Same methodology you have to use, exactly same. All of you should get it. Just see up to what height the center of mass goes down. Okay, Mayur got the answer. Others? Shomik. Ariman. Fine. So center of mass is here, right? So how much is the height of center of mass from the zero potential energy now? This is the height, right? This distance is how much? What do you think? This is L by 2. From here to here, the distance is L by 2. So this height is L by 2 sine theta. Okay. So all you have to do in this equation, rather than writing U2 as mg minus of mg L by 2, you should write minus of mg L by 2 sine theta. So the factor of sine theta will come in the expression root 3g by L sine theta is the answer for this particular case. Okay, you can also check your answer whether it is correct by putting theta as 90 degree. If you put theta as 90 degree, this scenario is same as that earlier scenario. You should get the same answer if you put theta as 90. So if you're getting cos theta, you can verify that it is not correct. Fine, so this is how you have to do this particular question. Let us proceed further. All of you draw this inclined plane. There is this inclined plane on which a sphere is kept at the top. All right. The height of the sphere, center of mass is height from the surface. This height is h. All right. Friction is sufficient. Okay. Friction is sufficient for pure rolling. Pure rolling as in rolling without slipping. Okay. Now, when this sphere comes down, it just comes down. When it just comes down, you need to find its angular velocity. Omega is how much? Okay. And one more thing that you need to understand here, that in pure rolling, please write down, in pure rolling, friction doesn't do any work. The reason is that there is no relative motion at the point of contact. Every time instantaneous displacement is zero. So that's the reason why the friction doesn't do any work. So keep that in mind. You need to find out angular velocity when this sphere rolls without slipping and comes to the bottom. It's a solid sphere, okay? All of you take it as a solid sphere. Consider mass as M. Apply work energy theorem between this instant and when it comes down. Done? Should I wait? Okay, Tripan got something. Yes, Ankit. Srishti got something. Remember, when it comes down, the center of mass is still at a height r above the surface. Okay, I'll do it now. Let's say that this is my zero potential energy line. U is equal to zero, fine. So I can use work done equals to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1 between this point and that point, all right? Apart from gravity for which you are considering the potential energy, only friction is there which can do work, but since it is pure rolling, even friction doesn't do work. So W is zero. All right, K1 is zero. These are some obvious quantities. U2 is how much? What is U2?
So it will be MGR.
MGR, the height of the center of mass is R at that point. Okay. U1 is MGH. H is the center of mass. And K2 with respect to center of mass, it will be half ICM omega square plus kinetic energy of the center of mass, half M into VCM square, fine. And VCM is equal to R omega because it is pure rolling on a fixed surface. And ICM will be equal to 2 by 5. MR square. So when you substitute all of this, you get the answer. Okay. Clear, right? All of you clear about it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. We'll continue solving questions. Suppose there is a rod like this, very similar to one question which you have already solved. So this one, most of you should get it right. This rod of mass M and length L, okay? It can rotate on a vertical plane, okay? You need to find out what will be its angular velocity when it has made an angle of theta. It, when you push it a little bit, it starts falling down about this fixed axis. All right, what will be its angular velocity when it makes angle theta with the vertical?
Sir, in the previous question's answer, you don't get theta in the answer, sir.
Yeah, you may not get theta because directly h is given to you.
Sir, so angle of inclination doesn't affect the angular velocity of the object?
It will affect the height, na? Height is indirectly related to it.
Okay, sir.
Done. Anybody got the answer? Center of mass is here. Stone. Okay. Let's say we are assuming this horizontal line to be zero potential energy. Okay. So I have to use this formula. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Fine. So W is zero. K1 is zero, right? U1 is what? Anyone? The height of center of mass is L by 2. So U1 is
mg L by 2.
Okay, U2 is what? The height of center of mass will be now what? This distance should be L by 2, location of center of mass.
L by 2 sine theta into mg.
Why sine theta? Cos theta, right? The height will be cos theta, this distance. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Drop a 90 degree. This is theta. L by 2 sine theta will be horizontal distance. Okay, be careful. So mg L by 2 cos theta is U2, fine. And K2 is half moment of inertia about the fixed axis, which is ML square by 3 into omega square, all right? So the answer you will get for angular velocity omega is, are you getting this? Root 3G 1 minus cos theta by 2L. Anybody got this?
Sir, I got 5L instead of 2L.
When you solve this, you get 5 or 2? I'm directly writing it. So that's
no,
what.
No, the 2 is correct.
This one is correct, na?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the correct answer. So when you rearrange the terms, this is what you'll get. Fine. Now, one more question on the same scenario is this. So you need to find
so the
out.
2 won't be there, the denominator.
2 will not be there. Okay. Root 3g by L, 1 minus cos theta. Okay. So let's say that the hinge is applying force. One force it is applying, one component of force is perpendicular to rod. Another component of a force is along the rod like this. Let's say this is F perpendicular and this is F parallel. So you need to find what is the perpendicular component of the force the hinge is applying and what is the parallel component of the force the hinge is applying. Try doing this. The hint is you have to use net external force is equal to mass time acceleration of center of mass. So the parallel component of force along this direction, is there any acceleration along the rod? Tell me.
No, sir.
No.
Centripetal
acceleration, omega square L by 2, which is V square by R also. So the parallel component of force is M into omega square L by 2. Got it? So this is mg by 3 mg by 2, 1 minus cos theta. This is the parallel component of force. How do you find the perpendicular component of force? Mass into the perpendicular component of acceleration. This one. And how do you get that? This component of acceleration, how will you get it? It will be alpha into L by 2? Yes or no?
Yes.
And how will you get alpha?
Torque is equal to IR.
Torque equation. Okay. So if this is theta and that is mg, torque because of mg is mg sine theta into L by 2. This is equal to I alpha. ML square by 3 times alpha. 3g sine theta by 2L is alpha. So m alpha L by 2 is the answer. So you'll get 3g by 4 sine theta into m, sorry. Is it clear to all of you? Are you able to understand? Any doubts? Is it clear?
Well, the perpendicular force plus mg sine theta will be equal to mg.
Correct.
Sorry about that. So the perpendicular force plus mg sine theta, this will be equal to mass time acceleration perpendicular to the rod. So perpendicular force will be mg sine theta. So that will be equal to negative of mg by 4. Negative means the direction will be reversed now. Alright, so total force will be root over F parallel square plus F perpendicular square. Clear to all of you? Any doubts? Quick. Alright, so see, we'll take two breaks today. Right now, we can take, let's take around 5 to 10 minutes break now. We'll take another small break in between. Let's take 10 minutes break. 10 minutes, two break we'll be taking, okay? Rather than taking a bigger break, one bigger break. All right, 10 minutes break. We'll see you on the other side. Okay, so all of you are back?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us take one more before moving to the next concept. This is a disk, okay? It's a disk of mass M and radius R. This disk can rotate about this axis. The axis passes through the surface of the disk. Understood? So it can flip over. So when it flips over, what will happen? So when it flips over, this is what will happen. It will flip on a vertical plane. So you need to find out its angular velocity when it flips over. This distance from the center and the axis distance is r by 2. Same work energy theorem only you have to use again and again. Those who joined just now, there is a disk, mass M, radius R. The disk can rotate about this horizontal axis. When the disk flips over, you have to find its angular velocity. I'll give you hints. You have to use, first of all, work energy theorem. There is a fixed axis. Clearly, this is a fixed axis. So kinetic energy will be half I about fixed axis into omega square. Work done by all the forces will be zero. Take this horizontal line, which is axis itself, as zero potential energy. Now you can write down U1, U2, K1, K2. Okay, Shrishti got some answer. Others, even Shomik. Should I proceed? All right. So we have already calculated moment of inertia about this axis, horizontal axis, which is at a distance of r by 2, right? If you remember, we have calculated moment of inertia as ICM, which is mr square by 4 plus m into r by 2 whole square. Like this, we have calculated, and we have found out that about that axis, it is mr square by 2. Fine. So I can say that k1 is 0. U1 is how much? Anyone? Mg into?
R by 2.
Good. This is that k2, I can write it as half moment of inertia about the fixed axis, which is mr square by 2 into omega square. And u2, now it is going down. U2 will be equal to minus of mg r by 2, where w is equal to 0. Okay. Now when you substitute this, you'll get the answer. This came in JEE Advanced a couple of years back.
Where is the answer? 2 under root g by r.
Whatever comes out from here, I don't exactly remember, but I've given you all the values, right? Okay, so this is the concept of work energy on a rigid body. Now you can take up different types of questions on work energy, how to apply work energy theorem on a rigid body. All right, now let us go to the last concept of this chapter, which is angular momentum. Write down. This is the fourth class we are having on this chapter. Longest we have spent on any particular chapter. Angular momentum or angular impulse. And angular impulse, sorry. Do you remember linear momentum? What was it? Linear momentum is what? What does it denote? Linear momentum tells you the amount of linear motion. Okay, it quantifies what is the amount of motion. All right, and there is a formula also, mass times velocity. Okay, this is how we quantify the linear momentum. Okay, whereas angular momentum is amount of angular motion. When I say amount of angular motion, I mean to say that how quickly the angle is changing. Okay. So there should be a way to quantify the angular momentum also. All right. But before we get into that, let us take a small example. Let's say there are two cliffs. Okay. There is this object that is falling vertically down. Fine. And someone is standing here and looking at it. You'll see the object straight like that. Okay. Whereas someone standing here, when this guy looks at it, he has to first look like this, then rotate it head like that, then rotate the head further like this. Okay. So like this, you can see that he has to rotate his vision to view the object. Fine. So what this tells you that this object has no angular motion with respect to this observer, whereas with respect to the second observer, the angle keeps on changing. Fine. So the angular momentum will be different for different point of observations. Fine. And hence, just like torque, even angular momentum is found about some point or along some axis. Are you getting it? So about every point, the angular momentum will be different, just like this example. All right. So let us now talk about how we can quantify this, fine? So clearly this example tell you that if this distance of the object from the observer becomes zero, angular momentum becomes zero, all right? So it is directly proportional to the distance the velocity vector is making from the point of observation, right? And not just any distance, the perpendicular distance, all right? So angular momentum, if you denote by L, should be proportional to the perpendicular distance, all right? And the faster the velocity is, faster will be the rate at which the angle changes, all right? So I can say that angular momentum is proportional to the velocity, and the heavier the object, more is the amount of motion, so it should be proportional to m as well. So if I combine everything, I can say L is equal to perpendicular distance into mass into velocity, okay? And in a vector form, I can say R is equal to R cross P, linear momentum. Fine. So this is how you write the angular momentum for the point mass. Remember, this formula is for the point mass. We have not learned about the angular momentum when we studied the point masses in laws of motion chapter or work energy chapter. Okay, we are learning about the angular momentum of a point mass in the system of particles chapter. Fine. This is the first time this concept is introduced. So first we are talking about the angular momentum of a point mass, which is perpendicular distance r into m into v. How to find perpendicular distance r? Perpendicular distance r is found out by extending line of velocity and then dropping a perpendicular from the point of observation. Okay. Let's take a small numerical on this. This is a horizontal surface, fine. You have a projectile that is projected at an angle theta, fine. Its mass is m, initial velocity is u. You need to find out its angular momentum with respect to point of projection. Angular momentum with respect to point of observation when the particle is at the highest point. Find out. Attempted? Okay, Tirpan got some answer. The projectile will go like this. At the topmost point, its velocity will become horizontal. What will be its velocity at topmost point?
Zero.
U cos theta.
U cos theta.
Horizontal direction velocity remains unchanged. Okay. So U cos theta is the velocity at the topmost point, and I have to find out the perpendicular distance of the total velocity from the point I'm finding the angular momentum, right? I'm finding angular momentum about this point. So I have to drop perpendicular like this. All right. This distance is what? Perpendicular distance, which is the maximum height also, right? Maximum height is my perpendicular distance, which is equal to U square sine square theta by 2G. Right? And the formula for the angular momentum is perpendicular distance mass into velocity. So this will be equal to U square sine square theta by 2G into mass into U cos theta. So M U cube sine square theta cos theta divided by 2g. This is my angular momentum when the particle is at the maximum height. All of you understood this? No doubt? All right. Now that we know how to write the angular momentum of a point mass, let us find out how to write the angular momentum for a rigid body. All right, please write down angular momentum for a rigid body. So suppose this is my rigid body. Before I draw that, to write cases. Case number one. The rigid body is, let us say, only translation. If rigid body do not rotate, it is only translating, then entire rigid body can be treated like a point mass located at center of mass. So just like we have been writing perpendicular distance into M into V, same way you write here as well. Okay. The difference will come from case two. Case number two, let's say it is fixed axis. Okay. And let's say this is the scenario. It's a rigid body. And let's say entire rigid body is rotating about this fixed axis, about this axis. All right. And angular velocity omega is given. Let's say omega is the angular velocity. Fine. So I can consider the entire rigid body as if it is made up of point masses. So let's say this is R1, this is mass M1. Similarly, M2 is at a distance of R2, M3 at a distance of R3. Okay. So can you tell me what is the angular momentum of mass M1? Quickly tell me. Perpendicular distance is how much of this mass M1 from the point? First, tell me what will be its velocity. V1 is what? M1's velocity is what?
R1 omega.
R1 omega. And what will be its perpendicular distance? So this is velocity will be like this. Perpendicular to R1. So perpendicular distance is R1 only. Okay. If perpendicular distance is R1, so angular momentum will be what? M into V, which is R1 omega into R1. Right? So L1 is M1 R1 square omega. All right. So total angular momentum is adding up everything. It is MI RI square into omega. If omega comes out because it is constant, it'll be summation of MI RI square. Now, what is summation of MI RI square? Anyone? This is what?
Inertia.
Moment of inertia about which axis?
Center of mass.
About the fixed axis. See, R is a distance from the fixed axis. It is not distance from the center of mass. Right? That is what we have considered. So this is IF into omega. All right. So we have got the angular momentum about the fixed axis to be equal to IF into omega. Okay, just like we have got the kinetic energy of a rigid body about a fixed axis simply as half IF into omega square. Similarly, angular momentum also gives you a simple expression IF into omega. Okay. Now, case number three. For case number three, we'll not do the derivation. It'll become very lengthy. Case number three, if it is rotation plus translation, it rotates as well as moves forward. Okay. For example, there is a rigid body like this. This is a center of mass. The center of mass has some velocity, VCM. And it is also rotating with angular velocity omega. Okay. And suppose I have to find out the angular momentum with respect to this point. Okay. So the position vector of the center of mass with respect to that point is RCM from this point. Okay. So the angular momentum in this case will be equal to ICM into omega plus RCM cross M into VCM. Okay. So we have got the angular momentum of a rigid body that is rotating as well as moving forward. You can remember this also like, you know, the angular momentum with respect to center of mass. Loosely, I can say it is ICM omega plus angular momentum of the center of mass. So this you can further modify as ICM omega plus perpendicular distance of the velocity of center of mass into M into VCM. But remember these two terms are vector quantities. So probably this direction may not be equal to that direction. All right. But anyways, I can write it like this if both the directions are same. Getting it? Now, can you tell me what is the angular momentum with respect to center of mass? If I have to find with respect to center of mass only, then what will be RCM? RCM will be what? RCM will be zero then. If I have to find about, let's say O is same as center of mass. If this point O is center of mass only over here, then RCM is become zero. So LCM will be equal to ICM omega. So the angular momentum with respect to center of mass axis is always equal to ICM omega. It looks similar to angular momentum about the fixed axis. Okay. Any doubts till now? Anything? So we have quantified the angular momentum for the rigid body in different cases.
Sir, can angular momentum be conserved?
Yeah, that is what we are going to discuss next. See, if there is no physical law related to angular momentum, then the definition of angular momentum is useless. I can randomly define something like, you know, let's call some XYZ as linear momentum into angular momentum. Then I can just randomly put a formula, and if physically it doesn't mean anything, or there is no law like conservation of angular momentum like that, then the meaning of that is not there. So we can't use it. Right now we have just quantified the angular momentum of particle and rigid body for three different cases. Is it clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we are coming to a law pertaining to angular momentum. And this law is called conservation of angular momentum. Please write down. Fine, so let's talk about this. So I know that for the point mass, angular momentum is equal to R cross M into V. Fine. So if I differentiate it, dL by dt, this will give me R cross M into dV by dt. Assuming R is constant, fine. So this will give me R cross M into A. This is R cross net force, right? So what is R cross F?
Torque.
R cross F is perpendicular distance of the force into F, R sine theta into F. Right? So torque is actually equal to rate at which the angular momentum changes. Okay? Just like the case where force was equal to rate at which linear momentum changes, similarly, torque is equal to rate at which angular momentum changes. And we have observed it in case of particle right now. For a rigid body, about the fixed axis, for rigid body, by the way, we use capital L for angular momentum, and for a particle, we use small l for angular momentum. So this is equal to moment of inertia about fixed axis into omega. Okay, so if I differentiate it, dL by dt, if the moment of inertia is constant with respect to time, I get IF into d omega by dt. What is d omega by dt? Alpha. So IF into alpha, and IF into alpha is torque about the fixed axis, right? So when I differentiate the angular momentum for a rigid body, then also I'm getting the torque itself. And I also know that the angular momentum with respect to center of mass is equal to ICM into omega. So if I differentiate this also, I am going to get ICM alpha, which is torque with respect to center of mass. Okay. So the way the angular momentum is defined, I can say that torque is equal to rate at which angular momentum changes. Fine. And just like the force, this force will be equal to M into dV by dt plus V into dm by dt. Even mass can change, right? But we, every time we ignore dm by dt term, we say that force is equal to mass m acceleration only. Similarly, torque can be observed when moment of inertia also changes. So torque will be actually equal to, when you differentiate, we are keeping I as constant. So torque can be equal to omega di by dt plus I d omega by dt, fine? So don't be surprised when you see these kind of things. But they are rarely, asked in a particular question, but you should know that torque not only depends on rate at which omega changes, but it also depends on rate at which the moment of inertia changes. So the first physical meaning of angular momentum is if you differentiate it, you'll get torque. Is it clear? Clear to everyone? Okay. Now we're talking about the second physical meaning. So for a system consisting of multiple objects, I know that the total angular momentum will be equal to sum of the angular momentums L1, L2. Suppose it has two point masses and two rigid bodies. Your system has four objects, two point masses, let's say two point masses like that, and let's say two rigid bodies. Fine. This is your system, four objects. Okay. The point masses are moving here and there, and the rigid bodies are rotating as well as moving like this. Fine. So this is a total angular momentum at any point in time, sum of individual sums of the angular momentums, the vector sum. So if I differentiate it, the total angular momentum, if I differentiate, I'll get dL1 by dt plus dL2 by dt. I'll get it like this, right? The first derivative, this one, is torque on the first object. This is torque on the second object. This is torque on the rigid body, let's call it as 3. And this is torque on the second rigid body, tau 4. This is my total angular momentum, okay? And we have already discussed that internal torques, when you add, will become 0. So when you add all the torques on individual objects, this will give you total external torque, because the sum of the internal torques will become 0. So this is your external torque. The sum of external torque is what? Rate at which total angular momentum of the system changes. Fine. So if external torque is 0, this will tell you that the dl by dt of the system is 0. It means that angular momentum of a system is constant. So the implication of this is that when they collide, their velocities and angular velocities could change, fine? But they will change in such a manner that whatever was the sum of angular momentum before remain the sum of angular momentum after the collision as well, Fine. So their angular momentum will be conserved. The only condition for angular momentum to be conserved about a particular axis is that the net external torque about that axis should be zero. Getting it? All of you clear about it? So if net external torque about an axis is zero, you can conserve the angular momentum about that axis. Is it very clear? Any doubts? Sudha, you have any doubts? Okay. See, in what Abhishek said something. In online class, you are like very, very quiet. But in a classroom setup, makes so much noise. Fine. So this is the conservation of angular momentum. Let us take a couple of questions to understand it in a much greater depth. Let's say that you have this is a rod of mass M and length L. Okay, there is a small mass M that is moving with velocity u naught, hits the bottommost part and sticks to it. Fine, it hits the bottommost part and sticks to the rod. You need to find the angular velocity of the rod after collision. First, you need to tell me, is there an axis for which net external torque is zero? Is there such axis in this case? Is there an axis for which net external torque is zero? Simple. Tell me. The axis of the hinge, Sudha is saying, okay, but are there forces from the hinge? Can hinge exert any force?
Sir, it exerts force on the rod. No, sir.
It exerts force, but the torque about the hinge for that force will be zero or not?
Yes, sir.
It will be zero because whatever force the hinge exerts, it passes through the hinge. So its perpendicular distance from the hinge axis is zero. And what about the torque because of mg? Is that also zero? There will be mg force also, right? Is the torque about the mg force about the axis also zero?
No, sir.
No. What is the perpendicular distance of mg from the axis just before the collision?
Sir, before it's zero, but later it won't be zero, sir.
So I am talking about just before and after collision.
Oh, okay. Yes,
sir. So just before and after collision, the line of action of gravity. The line of action of gravity is passing through the hinge, isn't it? So the net external torque just before and after is zero about the hinge axis. So I can conserve the angular momentum of the system, By the way, when this mass M collides the rod, is this mass exerting a force on the rod?
Yes, sir.
So there is a torque on the rod. External torque is there, na? The mass is exerting force on the rod. So can I conserve angular momentum about the axis?
Sir, but the rod will exert equal force back. So
if you consider your system, yes, if you consider your system as rod and mass together, then the force between small m and capital M becomes internal force. There is no external force. But if you consider only rod, then there is an external torque. Okay. But if you consider rod and point mass together, there is no external torque. Even the force between them become internal force. So now it is very clear that I can conserve angular momentum about this axis. But can I conserve kinetic energy about this axis? Can I do that just before and after collision? Tell me.
So it depends whether it's elastic collision.
What kind of collision it is right now? Elastic.
Sir, it's elastic because they stick together, no, sir.
It is inelastic because they're So most of the collisions will be inelastic or partially inelastic. Elastic collision is a very special case which usually do not happen. Okay. So whenever such kind of collision happens, some kind of energy will be lost in terms of some mechanical energy will be lost in terms of heat energy or sound energy or light energy. Okay. And hence conserving energy is not a good idea, but angular momentum you can conserve because the only criteria for conservation of angular momentum is net external torque about that axis should be zero, and which is fulfilled over here. Okay, so please conserve the angular momentum before and after collision and tell me what will be the angular velocity after the collision. Okay, Tripan got it, Shaumik got it, but both are getting different answers. Can I conserve linear momentum here? Anyone? Is it possible to conserve linear momentum? Tarpan, what do you think? Can I conserve linear momentum?
No, sir.
Reason?
Sir, because there'll be normal forces which are external force.
Because there is an external force from the hinge.
Yes, sir.
So I cannot conserve the linear momentum, but I can conserve the angular momentum. Because even though net external force is there, the torque is zero. All right, so initial angular momentum will be equal to the final angular momentum. So initial angular momentum of the system is what? Only this mass is moving, everything is at rest. So it will be equal to m into u naught into its perpendicular distance, which is L, plus angular momentum of rod, which is zero. This is equal to the final angular momentum. So when it becomes a part of a rod, the entire thing is just one rigid body. Moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega. Moment of inertia about the fixed axis is ml square by 3 for the rod, plus I have to add the particle's moment of inertia also, which is this. Got it? So when I substitute it, I'll get m u naught L. This is equal to m L square by 3 plus m L square times omega. One L is gone. So omega will be equal to 3 m u naught divided by m plus 3m times L. Anybody got this answer?
Yes, no? Sir.
Who said yes?
So Kirtana.
Kirtana got it. Others did not get. Tirpan, you got your mistake. Shomik?
Yes, sir.
What was the mistake you're making?
I considered I added the masses and then did ml square by 3.
No, that mass is not distributed along the length. If it distributes itself equally along the length, then it becomes part of a rod uniform distribution. Shomit, what mistake you made? Okay, he's on mute. All right, so let us take one more question on this. There is a rod of mass M. Okay. There's a rod of mass M and length L, okay? A bullet comes from here. A bullet of mass M comes with velocity V naught. It hits the rod at a distance of L by 4. So this distance is L by 4 and the bullet comes out. The bullet comes out with half the velocity. Okay, it pierces the entire rod and comes out. Fine. You need to find out by what angle the rod will swing. This angle theta is what? The bullet pierces and comes out immediately. Find out the angle the rod will swing. Mass of the bullet same after passing through the rod. Yes, mass is same. Mass of the bullet remains same. So first you need to find out the angular velocity of the rod and then conserve the mechanical energy. But you can't conserve mechanical energy before the collision and after the collision. After collision happened, from that point onwards, you can conserve mechanical energy. Should I solve? Should I solve or wait?
Sir, wait.
Okay, I'm waiting for another few moments. Before and after collision, just before and after collision, you have to conserve angular momentum. Then after collision, to the final point, you have to conserve mechanical energy. Anybody close to the answer or got the answer? Shaumik, you got any answer? Anjali, you got anything? Arpita? Not able to solve this?
The answer is very long.
Okay, no problem. I'll just write down the equations. All right, so I have to first conserve the angular momentum, right? So initial angular momentum of the mass plus rod should be equal to the angular momentum of the mass plus rod final. So initial angular momentum is mv naught into 3l by 4, it's perpendicular distance, plus rods is 0, is equal to the final angular momentum is mv naught by 2 into 3l by 4. Its perpendicular distance is 3l by 4 from the axis about which you are conserving the angular momentum. Okay. Plus I about fixed axis, which is ml square by 3 into omega. Okay. So this will give you omega. Once you know with what angular velocity it starts, you can find out theta by using work energy theorem, which is W equals to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. So W is 0. K2 is 0. Finally, it comes to rest. K1 is half I omega square. There's a fixed axis, so I can use kinetic energy about the fixed axis formula. Half I omega square. And let's say that this is my zero potential energy, the horizontal line passing through the center of mass. So my initial potential energy becomes zero, whereas this point will move slightly up because it is going in a circle. So this distance will be equal to what? I know that this one is L by 2 cos theta. Total is L by 2. So L by 2 minus L by 2 cos theta. So U2 is mg L by 2 1 minus cos theta, right? So from here you get the value of theta. This is what you did, Tirupan.
Yes, it is all right.
Others, is it clear to everyone? Please go through it once.
Sir, you said the bullet like rips through the rod or whatever, sir. Huh. So, won't the moment of inertia change on the rod?
Yeah, we are ignoring the little mass that reduces for the rod. You're saying that some mass of the rod will fall on the ground?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The assumption is that this part L by 4 remains intact. You might have assumed this L by 4 falls on the ground.
Yes, sir.
No problem. I'm assuming it is intact. Any other doubt? All right. One more question then. I can see still there is little bit of discomfort with this concept. I will keep on solving questions. All of you, here is the next scenario. There is a rod that is kept on the horizontal table. Okay, this is the rod. The rod is kept on the horizontal table. Okay, then there is a ball that is coming towards a rod with velocity u naught. Okay, ball of mass m coming towards a rod with velocity u naught. After hitting the rod, the velocity of the ball immediately becomes downwards with velocity u naught by 2. Okay, the rod has mass m and its dimension is l. The length is l. Okay, it is kept on a horizontal frictionless surface. You need to find the velocity of center of mass of the rod. VCM is what? And what is the angular velocity of the rod?
That is the ball with the rod. Look at what length.
Sir, where does the ball hit the board?
It is at a distance L by 4. Sorry about that. Not given. Ball hits a rod at a distance L by 4 from one of its ends. Is it done? tell me, can I conserve the linear momentum in this case? Can I conserve the linear momentum? Take the poll. Can I conserve the linear momentum? Once you take the poll, the screen will be visible to you immediately after taking the poll. Take the poll and submit. Okay. Fine, so this is what people are saying. Now tell me, is there an external force, horizontal direction, on the system? System is your rod and the mass M.
Yes, sir, there's normal force.
Normal force is perpendicular to the rod, no? Normal force, the rod is kept horizontally and it is smooth. No friction.
Okay, sir.
So horizontally, there is no external force on the system. They are exerting force on each other while they are colliding, but that is internal force. So I can conserve the linear momentum along this direction. In fact, I can conserve linear momentum along any direction because net external force horizontally, any direction it is zero. So initial linear momentum of the mass is m into u naught. This will be equal to the final angular momentum m into vcm, sorry, linear momentum m into vcm for the rod, plus now it is negative of m into u naught by 2 because the final angular momentum of mass m changes the direction. Okay, so m into vcm becomes equal to 3m u naught by 2. All right, so vcm is 3m u naught by 2m. Okay, now tell me, can I conserve the angular momentum? I can conserve along the center of mass axis. In fact, any horizontal axis, I can conserve the angular momentum. But if I write about center of mass, angular momentum formula is pretty simple. ICM into omega about center of mass. And there is no fixed axis. So better to write about center of mass. So I'll conserve about center of mass, the angular momentum. Initial angular momentum of the particle is, let's say, m into u naught into l by 4. Its perpendicular distance from the center is that. Final angular momentum of a particle is negative of m into u naught into l by 4. U becomes u naught by 2. Got it? The initial angular momentum of a rod is 0. Final, you can say, is m l square by 12 into omega. So small L1 plus capital L1 is equal to small L2 plus capital L2. That is your conservation of angular momentum. Have you understood this, both the things? Any doubts? Okay, now tell me, how these particles will move. The velocity over here at a distance d, let's say this is at a distance d, what will be the total velocity of this point? How will you calculate? It is going to rotate like this. Omega will be in this way and vcm is forward. So vcm like this, this will be vcm and omega into d like that. Fine. So total velocity is vcm minus omega t at a distance d. Okay, so I can find a distance of a point which will be at rest immediately after collision. If it is at rest immediately after collision, then VCM minus omega D should be equal to zero. Total velocity should be zero. Okay, like that you can analyze after the collision as well. All right, let's move to. Now the final concept in this chapter, it will take just 5-10 minutes. After that, the chapter's theory is over. All right. That is angular impulse. We have learned in work energy chapter that the linear impulse is equal to the change of linear momentum. Okay, so the I know that F is equal to dP by dt. So integral F dt is integral of dP, which is actually change in the linear momentum. Integral F dt is called J, which is linear momentum. This is equal to delta P, change in linear momentum. Similarly, torque is equal to dL by dt for a rigid body. Torque dt integral is equal to the integral of the angular momentum, which is change of the angular momentum, right? This term is referred as angular impulse. Okay, so linear impulse is change in momentum, angular impulse is change in angular momentum. Okay, let's take a small numerical on this to understand the implication of this, how we can deal. So suppose you have a rod, same rod that we have taken earlier, like horizontal rod like this, and it is kept on a smooth table, and I'm giving it an impulse from here, J. J is the impulse given to this rod of mass M and length L. You need to tell me the velocity of center of mass and the angular velocity after the impulse is given. Try doing this quickly. All right, so I know that the linear impulse J will be equal to change in the linear momentum. Let's say that velocity center of mass is VCM. So J will be equal to M into VCM minus initial linear momentum is zero. So VCM is equal to J by M. Okay, this will give you V. Now, angular impulse, how to find? J is basically integral of F dt, and the angular impulse is integral of tau dt. So torque with respect to center of mass I have to find, which is equal to L by 2 F dt integral. So this can be referred as L by 2 integral of F dt. So you can see that the linear impulse into its perpendicular distance from the center of mass is the angular impulse, right? That is what you need to understand. The linear impulse multiplied by the perpendicular distance from the center of mass or about any axis, you're finding the angular impulse. Perpendicular distance into the linear impulse is your angular impulse, right? That is what we have got. So this should be equal to I omega, because change in angular momentum is I into final angular velocity. Initially it was at rest, right? I is ML square by 12, that into omega. Okay. So from here, you will get omega as six J by ML. Okay. All right, guys. So this is the completion of the chapter. We have done in great detail. Typically, people don't do so much for a single chapter, but since it is a biggest chapter of the entire physics 11th and 12th combined, so I thought we could spend about a month on this chapter. So we have spent 4 classes, that is 4 weeks on this. So you have got 4 weeks, and you know, this is the last class of this chapter. So you have another week. If you have not done practice for this chapter, I urge you that you must do practice from this chapter. Okay, make sure at least basic level or up to mains level, you are comfortable with the problem solving of this chapter. You are not going to get time later on. You may get time for school level preparation for this chapter. You will never get time for the JEE level preparation, which you have to do for this chapter. Okay. And there are multiple topics in this chapter. It is not very easy to comprehend in a very short span of time. That is another reason we have spread it into 4 weeks. So you have another week. By the time next class happens for the physics, you must do the basic problem practice on your own. At least solve 50 to 60 questions your own. Okay. Otherwise, whatever you have learned, everything will evaporate, and then you have to learn from scratch, from zero. All right. So we will take a break now, and after the break, we'll have last 1 hour of problem solving of the advanced level. Is it fine? Ten minutes break. We will meet right now. It is 3:42. We will meet at 3:52. Is it fine to all of you? Are you guys there? I should unmute everyone. Right, so we'll meet.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so those who are interested in solving advanced level problems, stay back. Others can leave if you.
Others can leave. He's telling. Okay, we will tell
him. No,
yes, sir.
Hariman can't leave. Okay, fine. If your focus is JEE Mains, you need to stay back. If your focus is JEE Mains, or if you want to learn something more on this chapter, stay back. Okay, all of you there? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, so let us start. Suppose you have a horizontal surface and on that there is a sphere which can roll, all right, and you have wrapped a string on it and then pulling the string with force F. All right, it's a solid sphere, mass M and radius R, okay? The friction is sufficient for pure rolling. All right, you need to find out acceleration of center of mass, alpha, and you have to find out how much is the friction on this. Just draw a free body diagram and write down the equations.
Sir, solid sphere, sir.
What?
Solid sphere, sir.
Yes. Whenever I don't mention, it's a solid sphere. Show the forces, mg, normal direction, friction, F, and write down the force equation and torque equation and pure rolling equation, straightforward. Anybody close to the answer, or should I do it?
Sir, one second.
I'll just draw the free word diagram meanwhile. See, you might be wondering which direction the friction will be applied, whether forward or backward. You don't need to break your head on that. You assume any direction. If your assumed direction is wrong, the value of friction will come out to be negative. So don't worry about direction of static friction. All of you drawn this free body diagram only?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Net force in the forward direction is F minus FR. This is equal to M into ACM. This is the translational equation, Newton's second law equation. Okay. Vertical direction N minus mg is equal to zero. See, the second equation is useless because friction is not related to normal reaction. Because we don't know what is the value of friction. It is a static friction. It can be anything between zero and mu n. It just introduces a fresh variable which is not connected to any equation. So you may not even write the vertical equation, vertical direction. Anyway, so these are the two translational, this thing, and the sphere is rotating. So net torque is equal to I alpha about the center of mass. Okay, because apparently there is no fixed axis. So I'll play safe and write down torque equal to I alpha about the center of mass. What is the net torque about center of mass? Quickly.
Sir, RFR, R friction plus R into F.
R into F, it is clockwise, plus R into FR, that is also clockwise. This is equal to I alpha. I is what? 2 by 5 MR square. Okay. So F plus FR becomes equal to 2 by 5. M R alpha. This is first equation, this is second equation. Do I have any other equation?
Rho is equal to R alpha.
It is rolling without slipping on a fixed surface. So there is another equation, A is equal to alpha R. Solve these three equations quickly and tell me what is the value of friction. FR is equal to what?
Sir, I got minus 3 by 10 MR alpha.
A and alpha are unknown. You have to get in terms of F, M, R, like that. Friction is how much?
So minus 3 by 7 F.
3 by 7 F, all of you getting?
Sir, is it right?
And I'm waiting for others to answer. Not sure what others are doing.
So I got A is equal to 10F by 7M.
Not A, friction. FR is equal to what? If you get A, just substitute in one of these equations. Get the value of FR. 3/5 f Vibhav is getting.
Yes, sir. Even I got -3/7 f.
Okay, so assuming this is correct, I know that force of friction, magnitude of that should be less than or equal to mu mg, sorry, mu into normal reaction. Okay, so for pure rolling to happen, 3/7 f should be less than or equal to mu times normal reaction. Normal reaction happens to be mg over here. So mu mg must be greater than or equal to 3/7 f. So it is not that for every force f there will be a pure rolling. Okay, this inequality must be satisfied. If you increase your force f to be a very high value, probably it will become larger than mu mg, then it will not do pure rolling. Okay, all right, next one. There is a sphere of radius r. Doesn't look like sphere. There's a sphere of radius r, mass m, radius r. It is a solid sphere. Friction is sufficient for it to pure roll. Okay, this distance, height of the center of mass, you need to find out how much it should be so that it should be able to complete circular path. When it comes down, there is a circular path also. It should be able to complete the full circular path. When it is coming down, it will not only have VCM, it will also have omega. So you need to find out what should be this height so that it completes the full circle over here. Got it? Got the question? Okay, do this.
So we have to imagine that path, like it goes and comes back to the ground.
You don't need to worry about coming back to the ground. Imagine this is like a full circle. It, when it goes in, there's a path to go in, but as soon as it goes in, the loop completes. You need to find out what should be this height h for it to complete this full circle. What is the condition that it will complete the full circle? Anyone? where is the highest chance that it will leave the circle?
Sir, at the opposite part of the
Sir, exactly at the top.
Exactly at the top, right? This is where it could leave the circle. So if it doesn't leave the circle path over here, it is not going to leave anywhere. Okay, so you have to write down condition for it to just leave the circle at the top. And for that condition, normal direction should be zero. From the top, normal direction will come like this. If this normal direction becomes zero, it means that it has left that path. Okay, so you'll get some relation among the velocities and everything. And remember, center of mass is moving in a circle of R minus capital R radius. Okay, so imagine the topmost point, the velocity is V. Have you written force balance equation over there that N plus mg net force is equal to mass time acceleration? Mv square by R minus R. Have you written this equation, anyone?
Yes, sir.
So at the topmost point, when it just reaches, let's say, normal direction is zero. So mg is equal to m into v square by r minus r. So velocity at topmost point should be such that v square is equal to g times r minus capital R. Right? So I have got velocity at this point and velocity initially also is zero. Both ways I have got it. So I'll apply conservation of mechanical energy between point 1 and point 2. Okay, so let's do that. Since no work is done, I can say U1 plus K1 is equal to U2 plus K2. Because W0, this can be modified like this. U1 is mg into h. K1 is 0. What is U2? Anyone? U2 is what?
Mg into small r.
Mg into?
2r minus capital R.
Okay, this height you take, center of mass is where? Total this height is 2 times small r. That minus radius of the sphere, okay, plus kinetic energy, which is half ICM omega square, which is 2 by 5 mr square, okay, ICM into omega square plus half m into vcm square, v square. And since it is pure rolling, omega square pure rolling So omega into r is equal to v. All right. So you can use it over there. And along with equation three, you can, this is equation three, you can solve the equation number four. Is it clear to everyone? Any doubts on this? Kirpan, you had a few doubts, right? Initially, you're saying something. You can ask now.
Sir, can you just solve some random sums from that DPPY thing? I didn't get any of them, I guess.
You didn't get any?
So some one or two I got, not much.
Okay, let me open that. DBP 2.3, right?
Yes, sir.
This is what?
Yes, sir. This one.
All right, let's take the fifth one. A cubical block of side length L and mass M is placed on a horizontal floor. Force F is applied at the end of the plane sheet PQ, which is firmly attached to the block. What should be the minimum value of PQ so that the block may be tipped about an edge? See, whenever such kind of questions are asked, you need to first identify what is the condition for it to tip over the edge. What do you think the condition will be? What should happen? Okay.
Force exceeds friction.
No, it will then translate, right? It will not topple. I'm saying when it is about to
topple. So torque will be greater than zero.
Torque is there, net torque is there, right? There has to be net torque. And what else? What is the other condition? If torque is not there, it will not rotate. Net torque has to be there. And suppose it is just about to rotate, then also net torque is zero, isn't it? Just when it is about to rotate, at that time also net torque is zero. And when force is very less, then also torque is zero. So what is the difference between these two scenarios when you draw the diagram? No idea. See, when it is about to rotate, the normal reaction will shift from O because it is about to rotate from point O. So normal reaction will be applied from here. This portion is about to lift, or it has just lifted a bit. It is rotating about this point. So normal reaction will shift that side. Getting it, Tarpan?
Yes, sir, but how do we use that?
Okay, how do we use that? You can now find out the torque about this point and equate that to zero. So when you do that, torque because of normal reaction will come out to be zero.
Yes, sir.
Okay, earlier you might have used torque from here. Sorry, in upward direction. This is the normal reaction. Earlier you might have done like that. But when it is about to rotate, this point is no longer in contact with the surface. Only edge contact is there. So from there, normal reaction will be applied. So many such kind of problems are there. All right. Everything else remains the same. You have to balance the force and equate net torque to zero. But the condition for it to just topple from point two is a normal direction has shifted over here.
And sir, like when you solve it, I think you have to assume mg is the torque because of the weight will become zero. Then only you get the answer that's given.
No, not like that. Let's try to solve it. Mg is like this. This is mg. Okay. Then force F is applied like that. So you can split the force into two parts. It'll be easy then. This is F cos 30. All of you read the question, okay?
Sir, won't the F cos 30 like keep it attached to the ground and not let it drop because it's acting downwards?
No, I've split the force into two components. What is the problem in that?
So, yes, sir, but the F cos 30 is acting downwards, sir. So yeah. it'll keep the block attached to the ground.
Correct. But
the top is missing, sir.
No, it will have a torque also. Suppose that length A is very large. So there is a net torque about O or not. It will try to rotate about O.
Oh, okay.
But you're correct that it will make sure the block is touching some portion of the ground. But as well as it will make sure that the it is about to rotate.
Yes, sir. Anyway,
so let's balance the torque about O. So torque because of F cos 30 is F cos 30 into A. Torque because of F sine 30 is in opposite direction of F cos 30 or in the same direction?
Opposite.
Right, so minus of F sine 30 into perpendicular distance is L. All right, torque because of mg is in which direction? Same direction as F cos 30's torque or F sine 30's torque about this point?
Sir, F sine 30.
All right, so minus of mg into L by 2 is equal to 0. All right. So from here you get the value of minimum value of A, PQ, which is A. So F cos 30 is F. Quickly solve this. Minus MG L by 2 is equal to 0. So root 3 AF is equal to MGL plus FL. So A will come out to be MGL plus FL divided by root 3 F. This is the answer. But answer is given in terms of L. So you need to do the force balance also. The force balance when you do, you'll have F cos 30 plus mg wait, you have to find minimum value of A. You don't have to find the minimum value of force. Okay, so sorry about that. Let me erase this right now. So basically what is happening is that this line of force is going like that. Okay. So if this, the value of A becomes large, let's say A becomes this much, then the line of force could pass through O. Okay. If line of force passes through O, if line of force passes through O, then the torque because of this force will be what? About that point? Zero?
Yes.
Right? Then will it be able to rotate ever about O because of the force? No, right? It will never be able to rotate. The normal reaction will not shift here actually. It will be somewhere here. But understand, if there is a rotation because of this force, it has to be like this. But torque because of mg is in opposite direction. Mg resists the rotation. But if this force direction passes through O only, then the torque because of force will become zero. So you need to make sure that this line of force is little bit away from this line. Okay, so the limiting condition is such that this line just passes through O. That will give you the minimum value of A. So if you draw a line like this and this line, the red horizontal line is a minimum value of A. This one. What I'm saying, this is the if it goes like this, then this force will have a torque which tries to rotate this body like that. Even mg is trying to rotate like that, so this will not rotate. So at least it has to be, this line of force has to be away from this line. All of you understood this concept,
sir? But even if the block rotates, it'll rotate about the other corner, no sir? It will not rotate about O if you put force on that side.
When? Right now?
Yeah, right now.
It will rotate about this point only when this line of force goes like this. There has to be a perpendicular distance from this point in that direction. Then only there will be a torque about this point like that. Right now about this point, because of mg, the torque is like this. And if this line of force is this way, because of that also the torque is in this way about this point. Are you getting this?
Oh, in that direction, yeah.
Okay, so both mg and the force torque in the one direction. So this force is not helping it to rotate. Therpan, you are getting it?
Yes, sir, understood.
So this distance is the minimum distance. And this angle is 30 degrees.
Sir, you have to use trigonometry to find
the... Yeah, trigonometry. This is 30, this is 30. 30, this is L. So that distance will be equal to L tan 30. L by root 3. Fine. What other question, Tripan?
So can you do the next question?
Next one. A thin uniform rod of mass M and length L is moving translationally with acceleration A due to two anti-parallel force. Minimum value of acceleration for which the rod may move translationally. Minimum value of acceleration. Okay, so basically, if it is moving only translationally, what does it mean? Alpha is zero. Understood?
Yes, sir.
So if alpha is zero, net torque about center should be equal to zero. So F1 into 2A0 minus F into, this will be how much? Total length is L. So F into this distance will be L by 2 minus A0. This should be equal to zero. And I know that F plus F1 is equal to M into acceleration is given A. So F1.
Sir, F1 minus F is equal to M.
What? F1 minus? Oh, sorry about that. Correct. F1 minus F is equal to M into A. Correct. So you have to find out minimum value of expression A. So A and F are the two variables, two equations. You can find it. What else?
It will start, like, if we're finding the minimum value of A, then A naught has to be zero or some. It won't come properly. So can you do it, please?
Okay. So this will be F1 into 2A naught minus F. I have to eliminate F from here. So F is equal to, or you have to eliminate F1. So F1 is equal to MA plus F. So just substitute it here, no? The value of F1.
Okay, sir.
So when you substitute here, you will get the value of A naught. You will get the value of A naught as a function of probably length L. Okay. And maximum value of acceleration for which the rod may move translationally. So then you have to maximize that A, all right? You can change the value of L, okay? So just get A as a function of L and change the value of L and find out for what L A will be maximum. Don't go by the solution. Try to solve it like this and then see whether you're getting it or not. What else? This question looks interesting. 10th. Did you do the 10th, Tripan?
Sir, no, sir, I was not getting, so I left it up.
Okay, try doing the 10th, all of you. Try. I'll put it on this. It'll be easier for discussion. I'll draw it here. This chapter is easy, or the fluids was easier?
Sir, fluids, yeah. Sir.
Before you did this chapter, fluid was the toughest one, right? This is small m. This is a sphere of mass m and radius r. Solid sphere. Everywhere pair rolling is happening. And let's assume that small m is going down. Okay. This angle is theta. You need to find the value of alpha, ACM, the value of acceleration for the mass m. This ACM is for the this solid sphere. Okay. And the value of friction that is there between the wedge and the sphere. All of you do this.
Sir, there won't be any torque due to mg sin theta, no, sir.
Torque about what?
About the center of mass axis.
Yeah. Entire mg and all its component acts through the center of mass.
So no torque due to that.
Hmm?
So no torque due to that.
Hmm. Okay. Because it passes through the center of mass.
Yes, sir.
Simply write down the equations.
Sir, I got the equations.
What? You're not getting equations?
Sir, I got it. I got the equations.
Okay. Try solving it now. I'll also write the equations. All right. This is T. This is T. Assuming this pulley is frictionless, if this pulley has friction, then tensions on both sides will not be equal. It's frictionless. Okay. Mg sine theta. Let's say friction is backwards. So this is Fr. It has, let's say, angular acceleration alpha and acceleration ACM, center of mass. And this is acceleration A. This is mg. So for the small m, I can write down as mg minus t is equal to m into A. Any doubts here? No. For the sphere, I can say t minus the force of friction minus mg sine theta is equal to m into ACM. How many of you got this equation? Did you get these two equations?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, along the normal reaction, the equation is redundant, but you can write that down as well. N minus mg cos theta is equal to zero. And now the rotation equation, torque equal to I alpha. Torque because of tension is T into R. Torque because of friction is R into Fr. Okay. This is the total torque. this is equal to I alpha. I is 2 by 5 m r squared times alpha. These are the four equations, but the problem is the number of variables. How many are they? A is there, ACM is there, alpha is there, friction, tension, normal reaction. There are six variables, only four equations. What can we do now then? What other equation can we write?
A is equal to R.
ACM, not A. ACM is equal to alpha R. This is my fifth equation. What will be my sixth one? This point, whatever acceleration of this point, should be the acceleration of this mass or not? Both these points will move together. The topmost point of the sphere and this point on this mass, they're both connected with the string. They both move with the same displacement, same acceleration. Have you understood this? What is the acceleration of this topmost point? Tell me. ACM plus alpha r is the acceleration of topmost point. This should be equal to A. Now look at this, these equations, and let me know if you have any doubts. Let's go through it once properly. Shomit, Tripan, is it correct? I mean, you have any doubts? Arpita, Aditya, Skanda. All right, so the chapter is over and the basic problem practice is also done, and you might have experienced the that this chapter is not very straightforward. You cannot wake up on a particular day and just do a little bit of practice and will not be able to master it. Okay, it will be a continuous process. So even if you are, I mean, even if you have done, let's say, 60 to 70 questions on this chapter, it is fine. You can move ahead for the next chapter. You can never master this chapter completely. Okay. So, but at the same time, you cannot just come for classes and, you know, hope that before the exam, one day before the exam, I'll sit and understand everything. You have to work very hard and make sure that this chapter is manageable for you, at least manageable. You cannot leave this chapter. Big weightage is there on this chapter for whichever exam you're going to take, be it JEE, NEET, CET, whichever exam you take, big weightage for this. All right. So that's all from my side. And the homework is JEE mains level exercises from the CENTUM module. And if you are aiming for advanced, you should also solve the advanced exercises from the CENTUM module. Okay, so, and the chapter name, you know, right, whatever we have done, the chapters are center of mass and rotational dynamics for both the chapters. There are not many questions. Fine. So that's it. We'll meet next week now. Bye.
Thank you.